A little bit greater this year. The Steelers 6-0, the Ravens 5-1. We begin this second hour of PFT Live. They get together for the first time this weekend, Peter King. I'll tell you, look, I both teams are on the short list of AFC contenders, and this weekend isn't going to change that. It's just going to go a long way toward determining who's got the harder path to a potential Super Bowl appearance, because one of these two teams is going to win the division and the other one's going to be a wild card and have to go on the road for most playoff games, if not all of them.
Here's the way I kind of look at the importance of this game and how these two teams see the importance of this game. About a week ago, a little more than a week ago, Eric DaCosta, the general manager of the Baltimore Ravens, told Rick Spielman, the general manager of the Minnesota Vikings, hey, look, if we are going to get this trade for Yannick Ngakoue done, we have to get it done by Thursday during the day. That's our deadline. And Spielman is wondering, what's that all about? And it's very clear. Eric DaCosta of the Ravens wanted to make absolutely sure that Yannick Ngakoue would be in the city limits of Baltimore on Thursday night, so at the crack of dawn on Friday, he could take his first of five consecutive days of COVID tests. And why would that be important? Because if he takes his COVID test Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, that means when Steelers week starts in full, on Wednesday morning in Owings Mills, Maryland, Yannick Ngakoue can walk into the locker room, be a teammate, have a full week of prep so that he can just not have a little package of plays against the Pittsburgh Steelers. He can play, if they deem that he should play, he could play 50 or 60 snaps in this game, in this must game for the Baltimore Ravens. That is what this rivalry is about.
And if he ends up starting the game, it will be his first start as a Raven against the Steelers. And frankly, Peter, one of the most shocking things about this rivalry is, as of this moment, Lamar Jackson has only one career start against the Pittsburgh Steelers. It came last year at a time when the Ravens were 2-2. They had to take the Steelers to overtime, and the Steelers didn't have Ben Roethlisberger. And that was a game that could have gone either way, and it feels like that was the thing that just kind of unleashed that Ravens team that would go on to win 12 consecutive games to close out the regular season. But Lamar Jackson was not great in that game. He had 161 passing yards, but three interceptions against one touchdown, 70 rushing yards, and he was sacked five times. That's the most he's been sacked in a regular season game in his career. And now he gets the Steelers for the second time. And, you know, the Steelers, when it comes to quarterbacks who like to run the ball, they don't suffer from the problem we spoke about last hour of pulling up and going easy at the sideline. They right. are going to, and I remember all the way back to 2012, remember the first time they faced RG3 and Ryan Clark said after he retired that the whole, and maybe even said it during his career, They were going to be as physical as possible every chance they got with RG3. And you know that they are still coaching their guys that way. They told them that a few weeks ago with Carson Wentz. So Lamar Jackson is going to step into a rough and tumble game, as Mike Tomlin said, and that's going to go a long way toward determining who wins.
Look, I think one of the big things about this game, Mike, is, as you know, and it isn't that Lamar Jackson hasn't won big games. He has won big games. You know, he clobbered the New England Patriots last year when the Patriots were on top of the world. So don't get me wrong with what I'm about to say. But this is a big game for Lamar Jackson because he is going to get pressure put on him both in the passing game and the running game. And it's incumbent on him to make plays in both. And I'll tell you this, if I am Greg Roman in this game plan, I know that whatever the Ravens say, because the Ravens said, hey, listen, you know, Lamar Jackson is going to play like Lamar Jackson plays. If he runs a lot, we're not worried about him running. Well, I think that is a great thing to say publicly. Privately, they don't want Lamar Jackson running 15 times a game. They just don't, or even 12 times a game. But I think this Sunday, all bets are off. If Lamar Jackson has to run it 18 or 20 times this game, That is the cost of doing business against the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Well, and this game takes on even greater importance, not just for who wins the division and who doesn't, but from the Ravens' perspective, they need this to fall as the postseason unfolds in a way that allows them ideally to avoid the Chiefs. And you got a far better chance of avoiding the Chiefs if you get a home game by winning the division, if you get the one seed and get a week off. It still may be inevitable that they're going to come up against their kryptonite, as Lamar Jackson characterized them, but you've got a much better chance of getting lucky, and maybe someone else goes into Arrowhead Stadium and maybe the Chiefs are peeking ahead or just flat that day or whatever the case may be, like what happened a few weeks ago when the Raiders went in and beat them. You know, when it's not an opponent that gets the full focus of everyone in the organization, that's when that opponent has an opportunity to beat the Chiefs. That's what the Ravens are ultimately hoping for. And if they're not, they need to be. And that's why this game's so critical. This should have a postseason feel, because the result of this game will echo into the postseason, Peter.
No question about it. And Mike, I think the one other thing to realize about this game is that these two teams are going to play again in 3 weeks. You know, they play on Thanksgiving night on NBC. And in that little sort of, not a quick turnaround, but close proximity of these games, I think what it does is that it really sort of collapses the huge and meaningful games into this short window. And if you look at the rest of the season, if I was both the Steelers and the Ravens, I'd be very happy about that. Because the last thing I want to do is play your absolute blood arch rival on January 3rd and then have to play perhaps a postseason game the following week, maybe even on the road. And you probably would have to play it on the road. But I look at it like the schedule makers almost did these two teams a favor. You know, the Ravens coming out of their bye, they're well-rested for this first game. And look, it's not great for the Steelers because they had a very physical game and a disappointing game in the eyes of some when they went to Tennessee and survived. I talked to T.J. Watt Sunday night. He was all bummed out because he thought they gave up too much on defense. But I think this is really a good opportunity for both teams. I think they'll probably split it, Mike. They're both so good. But I think it's good for both of them that they are through with this sort of the bloodlust games by December 1st.
And let me echo a point that I always make about week one of the season. Week one, I say that the outcome of the game doesn't matter unless you lose at home to a division rival, because you have to go there later. And if you get swept, chances of winning the division go down dramatically. Consider where they are right now, 6-0, 5-1. Steelers get the advantage in Baltimore, 7-0, 5-2. You got a two-game spread, plus the Steelers already hold the tiebreaker. If the Steelers would win Thanksgiving night at home, complete the sweep, guarantee the tiebreaker, have a three-game lead in the standings if they otherwise both win their games, you're not making that up the rest of the way, because you have to first right. catch them, then finish one game ahead of them. There aren't enough games in a season to do that when you're chasing a great team like the Steelers. Peter, look at the Steelers' schedule. They're going 13-3 this year, barring some sort of a collapse. The track they're on, minimum 13-3. And if they could steal this one, and that was not an intended pun, and I even groaned thinking about the accidental pun, but if they can steal this one on Sunday in Baltimore, they are in excellent, excellent shape to win the division and possibly to end up being the one seed in the AFC.
Well, you're right about that. I think one of the great things about the schedule this year is that it has allowed for multiple teams to have a real legitimate opportunity to be that one seed. Tennessee is still in the ball game because of the relative weakness of the AFC South. Obviously, Kansas City is very much in it. Even though Kansas City has a tough schedule and a lot of tough games down the stretch. And I think, obviously, if Pittsburgh wins this week, I'll say this. I think if Pittsburgh wins this week, looking at the comparative schedules, hard for me to imagine how they're not going to be the one seed. Winning at Baltimore with the second game being in Pittsburgh. And look, I said I thought they would split. I think they'll split. But boy, if the Steelers win this week, I think it's going to be really, really hard, obviously, for Baltimore not only to catch them, but to pass them to be the one seed in the AFC.
In the NFC West, last year the one seed came all the way down to week 17, the final drive in Seattle. The Seahawks had chances, which would have relegated the 49ers to the 5 seed. They get together in Seattle again this weekend. No fans will be there. 12th man not a factor for the Seahawks this year. But the 49ers surging, 2 straight wins after getting embarrassed at home by the Miami Dolphins. Seahawks lost their first game of the year on Sunday night, that epic classic overtime, 69 minutes and 45 seconds against the Cardinals. Let's first hear from Brian Schottenheimer, the offensive coordinator of the Seattle Seahawks, on this year's concept in Seattle of letting Russ cook. Here he is.
It was certainly something that we heard, we talked about, you guys asked about it quite a bit. It's just kind of the way we're playing right now. We're playing with a lot of confidence, throwing the football. We're still running the ball really, really well. I don't think we think we're going to go into Arizona and rush for 200 yards against them, but we do. And so, the term is fun. The term is catchy. Fans love to talk about it. But I literally don't sit up there in the staff room with the staff, and we don't put on a chef's hat, and we don't pull out our recipe books and be like, hey, it'll cook on this one. I mean, we don't do that, you know? We just come up with the best plays we can come up with, and some of them work, you know, and some of them don't. And he's playing with a lot of confidence right now, and you know, we knew at some point we might lose a game, and you know what? We did lose a game, and if anything, it motivated us to get back to work. But I think it's fun for the fans. I think it's fun for people to talk about. But at the end of the day, we want to win. And if that takes us not letting Russ cook, okay, we'll do that too. If we think we got to let Russ cook, or that's the way the game unfolds, and we'll be pulling out our recipe books and mixing all the different ingredients and seeing how it tastes.
You know, the most telling thing he said there, Peter, was they're coming up with the best plays they can to get the most out of the offense. That's how Russ cooks. That's the deviation from the past that Russell Wilson desperately wanted. He wanted there to be creativity. He didn't want it to be, let's run the ball, let's run the ball, let's run the ball, and let's try to have a controlled game plan and rely on our defense. And then if we're down by one or more scores in the fourth quarter, I have to come in and try to save the day. They wanted to see, Wilson and his camp wanted to see that effort to come up with plays to take advantage of the fact that he's one of the best quarterbacks in football. And finally, after 8 years, they're doing that, and he's getting to show that he belongs in that conversation with the best in the game.
Look, you know, the Seattle Seahawks are averaging 34 points a game. Russell Wilson is on pace for the first time in his career to throw for 4,500 yards and to throw for, you know, whatever, 48 or 50 touchdowns. So, you know, Mike, I look at last week, the bizarre, ridiculous, incredible, most entertaining game of this season, the loss at Arizona. And I just say, you know, that is really, honestly, the cost of doing business. When your defense isn't that good, and when you have an absolutely electric quarterback who occasionally is going to throw an interception. But, you know, the one thing I look at right now this season, if I look at the Seattle Seahawks, as you look at right now on your screen, the defensive ranks of the Seahawks, I look at some point soon, they are going to have a new run stuffer in Snacks Harrison, who's getting ready to play in Seattle, who's been signed. They are going to have Jamal Adams back to anchor the secondary, and they're going to get Carlos Dunlap probably starting next week to be able to rush the passer a little bit better. And so those are three important elements to making sure that Russell Wilson doesn't have to put up 36 a game for them to be able to win every game down the stretch. It's like, Mike, if I am doing the NFL hierarchy right now, okay, there's nobody who I would be more afraid of facing as an offense right now today than the Seattle Seahawks, because Russell Wilson is so dangerous in multiple ways. But I think I could beat him, because if I got a pretty good offense, I get a good chance of scoring 30. Well, enjoy that while you can. I don't know if you're going to be able to be saying that in 2 or 3 weeks.
Well, and that's the most immediate challenge for the Seahawks with that defense that's still overmatched, with Jamal Adams still out of practice nearly 5 weeks from when he suffered the groin strain against the Cowboys. The 49ers bring in that creative offense that can run from every position on the field. Now, they're down a lot of tailbacks. They're down to basically Jerick McKinnon and Jamichael Hasty, unless they can get Tevin Coleman activated this weekend. But that's going to be the challenge.
Doesn't
matter.
Who's going
to stop who? But who's going to stop? But the we saw what the 49ers offense did against New England last week with that running game. Can the Seahawks stop that 49ers running game and passing game as needed? So what's it going to be? Is it going to be a shootout? Is it going to be one team running the ball, one team throwing the ball, and it's going to be 41-38?
Look, here's the way the 49ers, I think, are going to play this game. You know, and I've told this story before, but, you know, when the New York Giants were getting ready to play the Super Bowl in January of 1991 against the Buffalo Bills, the Giants had just survived beating the San Francisco 49ers in the NFC Championship game 15-13, where the Buffalo Bills were the most powerful offense in recent years in the NFL. They beat the Raiders 51-3 in the AFC title game. So after the Giants finished winning at San Francisco, Bill Parcells gets on the bus and he looks at Ron Earhart, his offensive coordinator, and he says, shorten the game. So what do the Giants do? They possess the ball for 41 minutes against the Buffalo Bills, and they win an absolute stunner in that Super Bowl when Scott Norwood misses wide right with the field goal. What I'm saying is Kyle Shanahan, in my opinion, I mean, everybody, all I can say is this. Everybody on Sunday night is going to know who Jamichael Hasty is, okay? Because in my opinion anyway, Jamichael Hasty is the latest in the long stable of running backs that Bobby Turner, who nobody in America knows, but everybody should know. He's the one who got Terrell Davis, you know, to have the opportunities enough to make the Pro Football Hall of Fame. The longtime running backs coach for Mike Shanahan is now Kyle Shanahan's coach, and I don't care. You put in any running back in that situation. You know what Jimmy Garoppolo told me after the New England game? He said, you know, they're way ahead. It's late in the game. It's in the fourth quarter. And Bobby Turner is coaching Jamichael Hasty down the stretch of that game, which has long since been decided. Like, it's early in the first quarter, and this is the most important carry of his career. So Bobby Turner will have Jamichael Hasty ready if he needs to carry it 23 times on Sunday.
Hey, and let's flip that around as well. This is worth pointing out. Rookie DJ Dallas from Miami, fourth-round draft pick of the Seahawks, he's the only tailback who practiced yesterday for Seattle. All the others did not practice due to injury. So it could be Jamichael Hasty, DJ Dallas having a major impact on the outcome of this game. But, you know, you're right, Peter. When you've got a high-octane offense on the other side of the ball, the best thing you can do is keep them on the sidelines. And we don't see that enough. But the 49ers have the offense that's constructed to do that with long methodical drives and milk the clock and just keep Russell Wilson frustrated. So when he is on the field, maybe he presses a little bit. And, you know, DK Metcalf last week was other than the great play against Buda Baker, which was one of the all-time great offensive player becomes defensive player moments in NFL history, where was DK Metcalf? He had the potential game-winning touchdown called back by a holding penalty, which was a legitimate holding call. It wasn't a ticky-tack thing, but they got to get the ball more to DK Metcalf if they want to beat the 49ers, don't they?
I think so, and I'm sure that they know that looking back at the game tape. But, you know, Mike, we wouldn't be saying anything about DK Metcalf and his offensive play if the holding, you know, call hadn't happened. And it's interesting. I watched that game back again yesterday, in part because I wanted to watch the DK Metcalf play 100 times more. But I also just wanted to see. It was such a crazy game. I wanted to get in my head exactly how it ended. And you're right. DK Metcalf, that was absolutely unequivocally a holding call on that. My question is, if the hold hadn't been made, would DK Metcalf been able to get through the traffic and have been able to score the touchdown. And even if he didn't score, obviously they're about 25 yards to the better than, you know, getting the play nullified and then getting the penalty. So, you know, to me, that was, you know, the play of the game, you know, when that hold was called. But, you know, I don't know, Mike. I look at it, and Seattle has won a bunch of games like that this year where they were the last team standing, you know, against Minnesota, you know, where they won, and against, you know, the Patriots game where they stopped Cam Newton at the 2-yard line on the last play. And so, you know, Seattle, I'm nobody should cry for Seattle, you know, because they're 5-1 and oh my God, they're not going to go undefeated or whatever. They weren't going undefeated anywhere. Their defense is just not good enough.
Yeah, they live dangerously, and it works out for them until it doesn't, and it didn't on Sunday night. We'll see if it does on Sunday afternoon against the 49ers. Saints and Bears getting together in Chicago. The Bears actually have the better record at 5-2. They've played one more game. The Saints have had their bye, but that offense for the Chicago Bears has been abysmal. Matt Nagy, the head coach of the team, was beside himself after Monday night's loss to the Rams. He was distressed by the fact that the defense of the Bears scored more points than the offense of the Bears. It was 7 for the defense, 3 for the offense. No offensive touchdowns last week. Nick Foles not looking very good at all right now. I just wonder how this one is going to play out for him specifically, because he doesn't have enough time to set up and throw. There was that strange dispute, question, whatever, that emerged when Brian Griese was filling garbage time on Monday night, relating a story from Nick Foles that sounds like Nick Foles was grousing a bit about some of these play calls requiring him to hold the ball too long, and he doesn't have time to do it because the offensive line stinks. And here come the Saints, who don't have a dominant defense, but they're good enough. Every defense in this league right now is good enough to put heat on the Bears because their offensive line isn't any good. And how do you make it any better on the fly? I don't know what you can do, and I think that's kind of where the Bears are right now. They don't know what the hell to do, Peter.
Yeah, I agree, Mike. This in no way is it to the level of the 2000 Baltimore Ravens, where the offense with Trent Dilfer playing quarterback and no weapons was absolutely putrid, and the defense was state of the art. And remember how they had to have all these meetings, and Brian Billick had to call on Ray Lewis and all the leaders on the defense. Hey, listen, you know, make sure that nobody criticizes the offense publicly. I mean, again, the 2020 Chicago Bears are not the 2000 Baltimore Ravens, but I'm starting to get the vibe that there have to be guys on that defense who finish playing a masterful game and at the end of the day walk into the locker room and say, are you bleeping kidding me? So I think that's something that Matt Nagy has to be careful about.
It was just a few weeks ago that Matt Nagy developed a gut feeling to switch from Mitch Trubisky to Nick Foles during a game that they were losing by 16 points in the second half against the Falcons, and it worked. But you know what? Nick Foles hasn't been great since then. Yes, they haven't lost every game, and they are 5-2. But you have to wonder whether it's getting to the point where Nagy's thinking, maybe we have to try something different. And if guys in the locker room are grousing, at some point what they're going to say is, why the hell don't we give Trubisky another try? What, we can't be any worse. We can't score fewer than 0 offensive touchdowns. Do you think that could happen in this game? Maybe second half, maybe if they're sputtering, a little Trubisky action?
I mean, if that happens, you might as well throw the, you know, the white flag on the season.
Throw the towel. I mean, throw the damn towel.
I mean, really, I cannot imagine that anybody on that defense is thinking put in Trubisky. Mike, they've practiced against him now for 3 years. They know Mitch Trubisky. And, you know, he's a nice guy. He's a really, really good person. But, you know, he's had very, very few moments that show you, hey, let's put Trubisky in. He'll save our season.
You remind me of Lloyd Benson there for a second. I've practiced with Mitch Trubisky. I know Mitch Trubisky.
And you, sir, are no Mitchell Trubisky.
All right, let's...
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.